Morning and welcome to the May 1st service for the Lord's Day at the Mesa Presbyterian Church. The announcements are found in the back of the bulletin, and I'll go over them briefly. Sunday classes, you're invited to join us for the Sunday classes. One is a Bible study that meets at 9 a.m. in the library. And then there's Going Deeper, which meets at 9 a.m. They have resumed the hybrid format so folks can attend in person in the conference room or via Zoom. And Holy Happy Hour at 7 p.m. on Sundays via Zoom. There's a Zoom Bible study held every Wednesday at 12 noon. After a two-year hiatus, the Arts Academy Barbecue Bash and Swing will be held May 14th from 3 to 6 p.m. here at La Mesa. It will include student art displays, dancing by the Valle Folklorico class, barbecue donated from the local vendors, with sides and desserts donated by RFK Charter School Culinary class. Wow. There'll be climbing walls, bike room, audio, and more for the children. The suggested donation is $10 for food. There's a sign-up sheet available in Fellowship Hall after worship this Sunday and next Sunday. Please, if you have an opportunity to volunteer, there's a lot to be done. Join me in the call to worship. We have traveled from the horror of Good Friday to the joy and celebration of Easter.
We will give thanks to you forever and
the Lord has turned our sorrow and sadness into joy.
We come now to worship the blood and transform spirit into resurrection and hope.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Our prayer of confession today will be done through both spoken word and song. Leon will lead us with the solo, and the people will respond with spoken word. We are yours, Lord, though we fight for control. Take our lives, make us yours. Friends, gospel, the word gospel does mean good news. The good news is this: though we can sometimes be very hard on ourselves, overly so sometimes, God forgives. God says, I love you, I forgive you, give yourself a break. Get off the pity pot. Sometimes that's what's also needed. I have work for you to do. I have creation for you to be a part of. I need you. Wow. God wants to use us. We don't always think of God as needing us in partnership. And perhaps the word need is not correct or exactly right. How does a sovereign God need? But God wants, desires, would like for us to join in what God is about in this world, forgives us and says, let's start anew. Let's begin again. Friends, this is the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And so let us share this peace of Christ with one another. Peace. Peace.
Different reasons, we all have different ways that we do this, but for me, there are some very important things. One of the reasons I give is children's programs. Though today there's no children here except for Ian, There's one. It's important that we have that funding to give a program to a group that needs guidance and direction and to be shown love from a group of people that maybe they only see once a week at holidays, but whenever they come in this door, they know that we're here for them. The next thing is the support staff. So I've been on the end of being a pastor's wife with no support staff. I've been up on Saturday nights typing bulletins, getting communion together, making sure when we had a specialized ministry that the church was actually going to be unlocked and available the next day for us to be at. So you don't know how much I appreciate that when I call, Dinia answers the phone. That when I walk in on Sunday mornings, there's a bulletin. You know, it's those little things that we don't think about. They just happen. And, you know, I'm thankful Judy doesn't have to sit up and do a bulletin at night, and she is too. Or that we have to worry about someone being here when we're needed. The other thing I am very thankful for is the community help that La Mesa gives. From everything from the food pantry to just the people that stop by and need someone to listen, to, you know, tell them that, you know, God's here for you. It's okay. We say a prayer for them, and it makes a huge difference. Now, I know giving is a subject that we don't always want to talk about. Budget has always been a bad word at my house. So it's something that whatever you can do, if you can just give. I'm not saying break the bank. I'm not saying, you know, double, triple, though it would be nice. I'm not gonna, you know, tell you not to, but just give. It makes things a lot easier around here and lets us be the church that God intends us to be. Thank you.
Thank you, Diana. Yes, if you appreciate your church family, community, and what we're able to do together, it is important that we give something. Every bit, little bit helps. So my time with children, I'm speaking to them, but I'm also speaking to the young at heart. I didn't bring my, oh yes I did. So my prop here is this bulletin insert that I'm going to let you take home once I'm done here. But in the Presbyterian Church, we have four special offerings. We have offerings that we do here every week, but all Presbyterian churches are invited to contribute to four special ones. And here at La Mesa, we give to two of them. We give to the Christmas Joy offering. I hope I get this right. And One Great Hour of Sharing. There is another one that's coming up called the Pentecost offering that I don't think we don't participate in that one, right? We do two of the four, is that right? I believe. But just to let you know, to fill in the gaps, what that Pentecost offering is, that's what this little flyer talks about. And I wanna read one thing that it does because part of that offering goes to help children and youth. Do you know somebody who is on the spectrum? Do you know any child or friend or somebody at school? We say they have autism or they have autism. Do you know anybody like that who's on the spectrum? I have a nephew who is on the spectrum, and he has developmental challenges. He couldn't walk until maybe he was like 4 years old. And he still is not, he can't talk to us. He can't speak to us, and he is 10 now. But he does engage, he does communicate with us with his hands, and he gets distracted. If there's too much light, does too much light bother you sometimes? Do loud noises bother you? Yeah, loud noises do, but not too many lights. If you saw a movie, would it, there were like flashing, like a superhero movie or too much light, would that bother you? No, that wouldn't bother you? Sometimes it bothers some kids. So I want to read something here that this Pentecost offering, the money helped with the triennium, what's called a triennium. It's a thing. How would we describe the triennium, Diana?
It is a youth gathering of 4,000 to 5,000 people from all over the world that takes place every 3 years.
Takes place every 3 years. Thousands of youth from all international as well, and they get together at a gathering. So the prospect of attending the youth triennium with its loud music and flashing lights was a formidable challenge for Josh, who was a young person with autism. But all God's children, including those with sensory issues, deserve a safe and welcoming space. And so that triennium was an inclusive and comfortable and inspiring experience for him, including Josh, because they changed some of the things that they did, and they created a safe space for Josh so that he and others like him could participate. So that's one of the ways that we, even though we're here, this is La Mesa, we can make an impact that affects and benefits kids that we don't even know. And that's kind of what Jesus wants us to do, to be loving and kind and generous, even when we don't really see how it directly impacts somebody else. Unlike the corporate world, right? Show me what my dollar, well, this tells us what our dollars are doing. That's helpful. Let's have a prayer. Dear God, we thank you that you love all children. You love all youth. We pray that we may be aware of others with challenges or who may be left out so that we can work to include as many as we can so that they too will know how much you love us and want us to continue to create positive and good communities. Thank you for our families, our grandparents, aunts and uncles and cousins, and for the family that we don't know yet. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Prayer for illumination today seems written for me. Calm our anxious spirits and quiet our racing thoughts, that we may hear your word of hope and challenge. May the familiar message be a comforting one, an unsettling call be an invitation to leave what no longer serves your purposes for life and love. Amen. The first reading today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 21, verse 1 through 19. Listen to the word of the Lord. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood in the breach on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." Then Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord. He put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there, with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and he did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Jesus said to him, "Do you love me?" Peter felt hurt, because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know what I love, that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." Thanks be to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Second reading today is coming to us from the book of Acts. And the bulletin says verses 1 through 6. I am going to include through verse 20 because I want us to have the whole story of Saul. Listen now for God's word. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." He asked, "But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Continuing the story of Saul. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias." He answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I've heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who invoke your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We are still in Eastertide, will be until Pentecost. Heard a lovely gospel reading about Jesus appearing the third time to his followers. But I wanted to focus on Saul. Saul, who became Paul. The label in the title here as a label in the Bible says the conversion of Saul. It's actually the transformation of Saul. Transformation. And I want to share some thoughts and have us think about what happens in transformation. I grew up in church, heard this word all the time, transformation. It was in prayers of confession, and it was in sermons and talking about, you know, being transformed by the Holy Spirit. I mean, it's in Scripture. But I always wrestled with this notion of transformation. It seems so radical. I'm not one whose experience in my Christian faith was one of those, like Saul. One day I was this way, and the next day I was something else. You know, you hear some people's testimony, and I was going down this path, and then the Lord delivered me, and then I'm going this way. Take that back. There were those moments when, yes, I got off of the road. I believe I got off of the road and had to return to the path. But it never felt like I was very far from where I needed to be. Because even in deviating on the road, I learned some things. Deviating from the way, as it's put, the way, capital W. So I couldn't relate to those folks who were living in a self-destructive path or whatever it was, whatever that path was, and then God came to them and Jesus spoke to them or touched them and they were converted. That's the story we seem to have of Saul. But I want us to think more carefully about transformation and the transformation of Saul, because one, it took time. It did not happen instantaneously. And two, it required a surrender of power. Yikes. That piece might be very similar and part of some of those testimonies that I have heard. They surrendered to God. Well, that could be said of Saul, who's very much in control, a man of power. I mean, he had so much power, he could arrest people, knowing that their lives were in danger and that they could possibly be killed. That's how much power he wielded. But when he lost his sight, he became dependent on other people. How could he not surrender? To be stripped of sight, stripped of the power of sight, having to depend on someone else for very basic needs. And not just for an hour or two or even one day, but for multiple days. This number of three comes up here as well. You know, the time that he's blinded. That number three is a signal, a symbol of, you know, 3 days in the grave and then resurrection again. It's to help us in our understanding of staying connected to resurrection, the story of resurrection and Easter. 3 days. Three. The Trinity for us as Christians in this day. But that's a piece of the overall story. But the process of waiting, that waiting time. I would like to think that our time through the pandemic, when we had to shelter in place and could not come and go freely, and we were dependent on what we heard on the news, from the scientists, from the doctors, we're dependent on somebody else's knowledge and expertise. And in a way, we were blind, could not see what the heck is going to happen next. Saul didn't know what was going to happen next. That must have really done a number on his mental health, as did the pandemic on our mental health. And looking back on that and all that we suffered and were challenged with individually and as a nation, it wasn't something that God did to us. The Old Testament and New Testament writers were much more inclined to think that when bad things happen, that's God doing something to us, for our own good, of course. But we don't believe that same way. I mean, that's a very ancient way of thinking about God. The ancients across the globe thought like that. We know and understand that bad things just happen. As long as we're mortal, as long as we're living on this plane, bad things happen. And it's not a loving God doing those bad things to us. And so coming through this horrible pandemic, being restricted, not being able to come and go as we please, was that an opportunity for transformation? Or that process of transformation? And if so, how? Have you been transformed because of the pandemic? Were you able to hear God's voice at some point saying, keep an eye out. Something's going to come your way. Something's going to emerge on your path. For Saul, it was this man, Ananias. This was a story of transformation, not just for Saul, but also for Ananias. Have you ever thought about that? The conversion of Ananias is not, it's not on here, but maybe it should be. The conversion of Ananias. And who was Ananias? A follower of Jesus as well. A Jew. And he knew the reputation of Saul. You want me to go see who? You want me to expose myself to this man who can arrest me? And technically end my life. You want me to go help him? But he does. Ananias is led down a different path in his life, as was Saul. Transformation happened all the way around in this story, and I hope that we don't miss that. In this Easter tide, the part of a resurrection that we often miss is looking for, seeking, and wondering, where is transformation happening as a result of resurrection? Okay, so we're given new life. Okay, so we're brought through a pandemic. Yes, we do. I hope we do. Take the time to say, man, I really hate that I can't do X, Y, and Z anymore. Or I hate that I have to do blah, blah, blah. I hope we can give voice to those feelings and acknowledge they're there. But we don't stay there. We say, okay, yeah, we admit where life is crummy. Have to be careful. I'm going to wear my mask no matter what when I go into a store. Maybe others won't, but there is always going to be that risk now. Along with acknowledging the crummy part of life, or what's happened because of this virus, how do we celebrate or look for those pieces that have changed and thank God that they changed? Anybody ever done that yet? You look back at where you are now and you say, okay, so this has changed. Thank God. No? No? Well, that's your homework. Look back at your time coming through the pandemic to where you are now in your life and in the life of the church. One thing where you can say, oh, that's changed. Hallelujah. I can think of several, but that's because I'm looking at from the outside. I'm looking at La Mesa from the outside, and I can see where there have been some changes because of the pandemic. And I can say, wow, that is cool. Yes, please do. I hope you do that exercise. And it may not take a renaming, a change in your name, to hopefully connect with a change inside, a positive change inside. Have you become more appreciative of the relationships in your life? Have you been humbled enough to let go of things that you gave your time and energy to so that you could really think about the value of those connections that are still with you? Has your prayer life changed? Has the way you've prayed changed in a way where you are... Well, I don't even want to say, because I don't want to put any ideas in your head. I'm just going to simply ask the question. The story of Saul, it's also a story of Ananias. Have you been challenged to see someone you saw as threatening or the enemy in a different light? That continues to be a challenge for me. I don't know that I'm as gracious or as trusting as Ananias, but I'm working on it. And that's the beauty of God with us through resurrection, not just through Advent, but even now in Eastertide. The beauty of God with us is that it's okay. You open your eyes and you see reality for what it is, and you remember that I'm with you. God says, I'm with you. You let the lesson of the empty tomb, you let the lesson of Saul, you let the lesson of Ananias be your guideposts. You let the table be your guideposts. Our closing hymn today is going to be one that recounts or brings to mind the disciples' early time. So it's not Saul, you know, after Jesus has died and the resurrection, but when Jesus is just beginning his ministry, the very beginning. So the last hymn of the service is going to hearken back to the beginning, which I think we need to remember. The beginning when we said, yes, I will follow you. Yes, I will be a disciple. Yes, I will learn. And yes, I will go. So As I've often done in my sermons, I try to pull the pieces together and remind us of the larger story of discipleship and the gospel lesson. The main one we have here that reminds us every month, and some of us wish it was more often, is that we are all invited to the table. The table is spread and prepared, not just for us who are sitting here and happen to find our way here on Sunday, this day, but it's really prepared for all people. And I asked the question one time to somebody, what do you think if we offered communion during the food pantry days? What would that mean? I don't know. Well, let's keep that image in our mind as we gather at the table. To the God who called Saul and renamed him Paul, who called Ananias to meet Saul, and who calls us, to this God, be honor and glory now and always. Amen.
Please join me in the affirmation of faith. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to not ask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of people on all sides, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily lives and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, come, Lord Jesus. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death
can separate us from the love.
Spirit, dwell with me, I will.
We no longer pass the offering plate, but we do offer a time for you to give your offerings. And you may bring them up now or always in, each week before the service starts or after. Please do be seated. So, can you? Yes, it's working. Thank you. Friends, this is the table of our Lord who invites us here. We don't come because we've earned a place at this table. We come because we are created, forgiven, and loved by God. So, we come. We come from different places, different life experiences. We come with much faith, with little faith, with doubts, with questions. We come because Jesus claims us as friends. And so whether we have confidence that we should be here, or whether we have hesitation, know that you are welcomed. Friends, the peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Jesus came into the world not to condemn the world, but to save the world. So let us open our hearts to the Lord.
We come to joy to the table of peace and the world.
We come because you, O God, invite us here, and we are grateful for your loving kindness. In love and kindness, you created a world of complexity and beauty. You walked with our ancestors and inspired humanity to create and learn in marvelous ways. The cosmos and the deep seas proclaim the mystery of your power. All creation sings your glory, and we are in awe of the world you have given us. You have walked with us through the dire consequences of our own missteps and have called us back to join you in repairing and healing what we have done. You love us with an everlasting love. And so, remembering all your mighty acts and with the faithful of every time and place, we sing your praise, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. O God, our rock and redeemer, we praise you for sending your Son to live among us. Jesus told your story and healed the sick. He was a friend of sinners and is still the friend of sinners today. By your power, you raised Jesus from death to life. And through his victory over the grave, we are saved and redeemed to live a new life. We trust in him to overcome every power that hurts or divides us. We live in the hope of reconciliation with neighbor and with creation. We praise you that as we break bread in faith, we shall know the risen Christ among us. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. God of creation, as anxiety and division continue throughout the land, guide us in wise decision-making, faithful leadership, and responsible action. May the health and safety of our communities and the most vulnerable populations be foremost in our thoughts. Remind us of the blessings we share and inspire us in the way of Jesus that sets people free from isolation and brings us into reconciliation. May we be encouraged by the gifts of those who have gone before us, the legacy of people who struggle for dignity and justice set the example for us. Holy mystery, God of yesterday, today, and tomorrow, sustain us by the power of your love to live and act in the way of Christ. Come, Holy Spirit, rest upon these elements and on us, that as we share this spiritual food, the bread we break, and the cup we bless, may be for us communion with Christ. Remind us that you have claimed us with an everlasting love. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours now and forever. United in Christ, we are able to bring these prayers and now pray together as Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, on the night of his betrayal, Jesus sat around the table with his friends. He took bread, he blessed it and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, Take and eat. My body is broken for you. Do this, remembering me. In the same way, he took the cup. He passed it around that table, saying, Drink from this, all of you, because this cup represents a new covenant of love, which is sealed in my blood, which is poured out for all. Do this, remembering me. And indeed, friends, whenever you eat from this bread and drink from this cup, you so proclaim the loving, saving love of our Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, these are the gifts of grace, gifts from God to the people of God. Let us share them now. Share it on first. For those of you at home, the body of Christ, living bread, the cup of salvation.
Thank you.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless God's holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all God's benefits. Stand in body or spirit. Been fed at this table, go from this place now and remember that the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit goes with you now and always. Amen.